Today, as we finish Hebrews, we embark on a new series. So, this Friday, today, tayo po ay mag-series break po muna. And we'll introduce you to the new series that we have. Ang ating anniversary theme for the 21st anniversary, We Shall Overcome. Ang text po natin ay hango sa 1 John 5:4. Let me just read them to you. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. So dito po sa text natin, natin hinango ang ating tema na we shall overcome. And what we'll do today is we'll just figure out why or how are we going to overcome the world? And then we will talk about the introduction to the new series. And to find out, how shall we overcome? Basahin lang natin yung context ng verse 4. Sa verse 1, ang sinasabi dito ni John, ng author, whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ, is of God, is born of God. Yan ang unang niyang sinabi sa first verse ng chapter 5. And then the other half of that verse, ang sabi niya, everyone who loves the Father loves whoever has been born of Him. So kung naniniwala ka na si Jesus ay ang Kristo, pinanganak ka ng Diyos. Yan po yung unang bahagi ng first verse sa kanyang sinabi. At yung kalawang bahagi, ang sabi niya, kung sino mang nagmamahal sa Ama, nagmamahal din sa mga pinanganak ng Diyos. So he's talking about our relationship with the Father, that we are born of the Father because of our belief in His Son as the Christ, and then that we love the Father as part of that relationship, but it also describes our relationship with one another. Now, if you love the Father, you also love those who has been born of Him. In other words, you love His children. The children loves one another. The disciples love one another. That's part of their discipleship, through discipleship, na talagang disciples sila ni Christ. At sabi pa sa verse 3, this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not burdensome. Ang commandments na tinutukoy po rito ay yung love of God. Yung command to love one another. Yan po yung context niyan. It's not talking about the commandments sa Old Testament. It's not talking about the Old Covenant commandments, yung commandments ni Moses. Hindi yan ang topic ni John dito sa 1 John, sa epistle na ito. It's about loving one another. At sa verse 4, dito nang galing yung ating tema for the 21st anniversary is that everyone born of God overcomes the world. This victory, yung word na pinagkuna ng salitang victory sa Greek ay nike or nikao, this victory is by faith. So yung victory na yun, yung keyword na yun, yung word na yun, nikao, we will discuss that further. Dahil yan ang pinaka-tema natin for the 21st anniversary natin. At sabi pa niya, who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God? So hindi ka lang basta naniniwala na si Kristo ay Mesiyas, naniniwala ka rin na siya ay anak ng Diyos. And we all know na ang pananampalataya dito sa ating tinutuluyan, sila ay naniniwala na si Jesus ay Mesiyas. So ang tawag nga nila sa kanya ay Jesus or Isa al-Masih. But what they don't believe about him, they don't believe him to be the Son of God. So ang kanilang banal na aklat nila, ang sabi doon ay hindi pinatay si Kristo, hindi pinatay si Jesus. Okay, akala lang nila pinatay si Jesus. Yun yung nakasulat sa kanilang aklat. Pero, ang sabi po rito, ang born of God ay hindi lang basta naniniwala na siya ay Mesiyas, siya rin ay naniniwala na si Jesus ay anak ng Diyos. Ito yung mga born again. Ito yung description ng mga born again. Ito yung proof na sila ay born again at sila yung makaka-overcome sa sanlibutan. Sa pamagitan ng pananampalatayang ito kay Jesus. Doon po naka-associate yung nikao, yung victory. Our victory is by faith. Not by strength, not by power, not by might, but by faith in the Son of God, Jesus Christ. Ayan. So, dyan naka-associate ang ating victory. So, as long as we have faith, we overcome the world. And this is consistent sa pinag-aralan natin sa Hebreo. Sa Hebrews, di ba? Tinuturuan sila doon, binibigyan sila doon ng mga warning not to go back or to fall away from their faith, not to turn around, not to go back to the old religion, but instead to continue to be faithful and to grow in faith. Now, sa verse 11, mag-skip tayo ng mga ilang verses. Another word na introduce natin from the Greek ay martyria, the testimony. The testimony is God gave us eternal life. And this life is in His Son. Yan po yung testimony na pinaghahawakan ng Diyos, pinatotohanan ng anak, pinatotohanan ng Espiritu Santo, at pinatotohanan natin. Yan po yung pinapahayag natin. That you will find eternal life in no one else except in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Kaya, kinapakahalaga nitong faith na ito sa Kanya. Dahil hindi matatagpuan ang tagumpay sa sanlibutan kung wala tayong faith sa Kanya. Yung faith na yon, yung testimony natin na ang buhay na walang hanggan ay binigay ng Ama sa pamagitan ng Anak. And if you have the Son, you have eternal life. At sa verse 13, yun nga, no, you must know you have eternal life. It is written, He wrote this epistle, sabi niya, sinulat ko itong sulat na ito para malaman ninyo na meron nga kayong buhay na walang hanggan. Na kung sino man sa atin hindi pa nakakaalam ng katotohanan ito, it's high time for you to know this. That you, because you believe that Jesus is the Christ, is the Son of God, you should know you have eternal life because you have been born of God. You have been born of God and you overcome the world. Kaya mo siya na-overcome yung world na to. Because this world is passing away, but you have eternal life. You have enduring life because you have the Son. Dahil nasa Kanya yung eternal life. Diyan natin na-achieve yung victory. Yung salitang nikao, usually ginagamit yan sa military, it's a military term and sometimes used in athletics. At nakikita nga natin sa modern Christians, ginagamit nila yung salitang victory sa sports. Pero dito, ginagamit ni John yung salitang victory sa pamagitan ng pananampalataya. Not militaristically, not in athletics, but by having faith in the Son of God, in the Christ. And as another reason kung paano natin na-overcome ang sanlibutan is in verse 15, no, we'll skip a couple of verses. So verse 15, sabi dito, if we know that He hears us, and this is the confidence that we have toward Him since we have eternal life, we know that He hears us in whatever we ask. We know that we have the request that we have asked of Him. Now, some Christians, they doubt yung katotohanan ito, especially kapag meron silang pinapanalangin, hindi pa nila natatanggap. So akala nila hindi pa sinasagot. But sometimes, ang sagot ng Panginoon ay either wait, that's the answer, or no, that's also an answer. Diba sa Hebrews na pag-aralan natin, sila Abraham, hindi nila nakuha yung kanilang ang promise sa kanila, and they died not receiving the promise. Because they're looking forward to a city whose maker and builder is God. So alam nila yung sagot sa prayer nila, kahit hindi pa nila natatanggap yun. Yun ang gusto nilang makuha. Na hindi nila nakuha yun dahil apart, they will not be perfect apart from us. Ibig sabihin, sabay-sabay nating matatanggap yung pangako. And sa verse 18, we skip a few more verses. We know that everyone who has been born of God does not keep on sinning. Yan pa yung isang nagpapatunay kung paano tayo nagtatagumpay. We have eternal life. He hears what we ask of Him. Those who are born of God does not keep on sinning. Hindi sila patuloy na nagkakasala. Ito po yung reasons kung bakit sinasabi na dyan that we shall overcome. That he who is born of God overcomes the world. Because they have the faith in the Son of God, the Christ. And because of that, they have eternal life because they have the Son. And they have that confidence that God hears his prayer. And then he doesn't keep on sinning. Kaya na-overcome niya yung world. So you cannot detach 1 John 5:4 from the rest of the chapter. Napaka-importante ng context para maintindihan natin yung meaning ng we shall overcome. We can only overcome if we have what is being described here in 1 John 5. Kumbaga yung verse 4 na yon, it just summarizes everything that John says in chapter 5. Without chapter 5, 1 John 5:4 can have any meaning you want. The chapter defines what 1 John 5:4 really is. Okay? So, another benefit of having that relationship with Christ and with the Father, he is protected by God from the evil one. So, chapter 5, verse 18, sa New English Translation, ang sabi, we know that everyone fathered by God does not sin, but God protects the one he has fathered. And the evil one cannot touch him. So God protects his children from the evil one. That's how they overcome the world. Because God is their protector. Because they have a relationship with Jesus. And they have eternal life. And they have the confidence whatever he asks, they ask of him, he gives them. In that, they don't keep on sinning. That's how they overcome the world. And then sa verse 19, yun nga, ang sabi, we know that we are from God and the whole world lies in the power of the evil one. So there, we are disassociated from the world dahil ang power ng world ang nagagaling sa evil one. No, tayo naman, nanggagaling ang protection natin from God. And they don't go together. They don't walk together in agreement. Now, the world and the children of God, they don't walk together in agreement. Dahil yung power ng evil one ay yun yung nasa world, sa sanlibutan. Samantalang ang protection ng God nasa children niya. And then, ang warning ni John sa bandang uli, is to keep themselves from idolatry. Sabi niya sa verse 21, little children, guard yourselves from idols. So to summarize itong theme natin, kung paano ma-overcome ng isang mananampalataya ang sanlibutan, is through faithfulness sa pamamagitan ng pagiging tapat sa Panginoon. And that implies that we love one another as part of our faithfulness, that we don't keep on sinning, okay? That we have that confidence, that we have eternal life. Yan po yung ibig sabihin ng how shall we overcome, and that's how we overcome the world. Now, although ito yung ating verse sa ating anniversary, 21st anniversary, ang pag-aaral po natin, susunod nating series, ay hindi sa 1 John, kundi sa Book of Revelation. And I just want to establish the relationship between 1 John 5 and the Book of Revelation. Dun sa words na ginamit natin kanina, binanggit natin kanina, yung Nikao, yung Marturia, at itong bandang number 12, yung Keep Yourselves from Idols. Dahil sa Book of Revelation, sa series nating, sa susunod nating series, yun din po ang tema ng Book of Revelation. Although maraming tema sa Book of Revelation, overcomers ang tawag ng Panginoon dun sa seven churches. At yung overcomers, sila yung bibigyan niya ng reward sa kanyang pagdating. And doon din po sa Book of Revelation, they were able to defeat Satan. Not just the world, but yung pinagmumulan ng power ng evil one, na-defeat nila through the word of their testimony, yung martyria. And not only that, because of their keeping the testimony that they have, that they have eternal life in His Son, dahil doon, they kept themselves from idolatry. Yung 5:21, yung sinasabi dito sa 1 John 5:21. Little children, guard yourselves from idols. Dahil doon kasi, they are threatened persecution and death if they do not idolize the beast na kung saan kumukuha ng power doon sa evil one. So I just want to establish the relationship between 1 John 5 and our series na that this na itong parehong sulat na ito ay galing sa iisang writer because of these ideas that we find from 1 John 5 at yung ating bagong series, The Book of Revelation. At hindi naman ito lamang isolated kay John, although si John madalas niyang gamitin yon dito sa Revelation, si Paul ginamit din yun sa 1 Corinthians 15, and this ginamit niya ng salitang nikao against death. Sabi niya rito sa verse 55, ang topic niya rito ay yung second coming. Sa pagbabalik ng Panginoon, those who belong to Him will be resurrected. At pag nangyari ito, no, Christ will reign, and then finally after Christ reigns, the end will come. And then, ang sabi pa niya, He must reign until death is finally defeated. So pagdating niya, they will be resurrected, and then He will reign. And then after He reigns, death will be no more. Kaya dito sabi niya, para sa mga believers, sabi niya, O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory, yun nga, ang word na ginamit dyan ay nikao, through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Again, ang victory dito ay nasa pananampalataya natin kay Jesus Christ. True faithfulness. This is how we shall overcome. So there are two usage of the word nikao sa Bible. No, dalawa yung gamit doon. The normal usage, ang literal usage niya is, binanggit natin kanina, military or athletic victory. At ang ginagamit ni John when it comes to Christians, kung paano magtagumpay sa sanlibutan, paano magtagumpay against death, paano magtagumpay against Satan, the evil one, is through faithfulness. Yan po yung dalawang gamit. And I'll show you example of those usage, yung dalawang usage na to from the book of Revelation. So, sa Ephesus, ang sabi niya, if you repent, now I'll just summarize kasi tatalakay na naman natin to in full sa ating series. Sabi niya, he's calling Ephesus to repent and then he will give them the reward to those who will overcome. Ang ibig sabihin doon, if you repent, no, you will overcome. Sa Smyrna, ang sabi, do not fear. May kanya-kanya silang struggles, itong mga churches na ito. And then sabi niya to the Smyrnians, do not fear. Ibig sabihin, if they do not fear, they will overcome. Although, may kanya-kanya silang struggles, may kanya-kanya silang problema, laging sinasabi dito sa mga churches, listen to what the Spirit says to the churches. Ibig sabihin, although isang problema nila ay unique sa isang church, the message is being delivered to all the churches. No? So, kapulutan nilang aral yung mensahe ng Panginoon sa bawat isa. And dito, we're just showing you a survey of how nikao or overcome or victory is used with regards to faith. To the Ephesians, if they repent, they will be victorious. to the Smyrnians, if they do not fear, they will be victorious and will receive their reward. To the Pergamum, to the church in Pergamum, if they repent, ganun din. To Thyatira, if they hold fast, if they remain faithful, they will overcome. To Sardis, if they wake up, they will overcome. To Philadelphia, if they keep Christ's word, they will overcome. And to the Laodicean, ang sabi niya daw, ang ginamit niyang figure of speech doon, I stand at the door and knock. Again, it's also similar, synonymous to waking up, repenting, or taking a stand, not just neither hot nor cold. Okay? So, sa ganitong paraan, sinasabi ng Panginoon sa mga churches, how they will overcome. Okay, sa Revelation 5:5, dito naman, ginamit yung salitang nikao pertaining to Jesus, how he overcame. The root of David has overcome. Okay, now, eto, yung dito naman, ginamit yung salitang nikao militaristically, no? Yung symbol ng white horse. The white horse coming to conquer sa Revelation 6:2. Okay, again, military ang usage. Revelation 11:7, the beast conquering the two witnesses nung pinatay niya yung dalawang witnesses sa Revelation 11. Now, dun sa Revelation 12, ang tinutukoy dito ay ang mga believers na sumasampalataya sa Panginoon because they defeated Satan, they dislodged him from heaven. Nawalan siya ng place sa heaven after he was defeated by Michael, the archangel. Hindi lamang po yun na nagdala ng tagumpay doon ayon sa Revelation 12. Aside from that, the saints also conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. So, andyan po yung ingredients kung paano nila na-overcome yung evil one. Of course, Michael is there. Wala silang, hindi nila responsibility yon. Si Michael na bahala ron. And they conquered him by the blood of the Lamb because of their faith. No? Yung blood ni Jesus, sacrificial death ni Jesus, out of their hand na yon. Si Jesus lang ang makakagawa nun. Pero they have conquered him. Ito yung kanilang responsibility. They conquered him by the blood of the Lamb. Ibig sabihin, they believe in Jesus. They were faithful to Jesus. And by the word of their testimony, yung kanilang marturia, doon nila na-conquer. So we have a responsibility paano nating ma-overcome. Yung tungkol kay Michael, si Michael na bahala doon. Tungkol sa blood of the Lamb, si Christ na ang gumawa noon. But they have, as believers, we have a responsibility to be faithful to the Lord and maintain the word of our testimony. Ano yun? Yung eternal life is found in His Son. Yun yung ating testimony. Okay? So, sa Revelation 13:7, the beast is granted by God the power to conquer saints. Military ang use nito. And all who dwell on earth will worship him. Ayan yung warning ni John. Sa 1 John 5, di ba? 1 John 5:21, ang warning ni John sa kanila, guard yourselves from idol. Dahil yung darating na Antichrist, yung beast, will be given power by God to conquer them and all who dwell on earth will worship him. Nakasalalay kataya ang kanilang buhay sa pagsamba sa idol nitong beast na ito. And if they don't worship him, they will be put to death or they will not have the economic advantage. Mawalan sila ng mga pribilehiyo. Alright? So, Revelation 15 verse 2, sabi naman dito, those who conquered the beast standing beside the sea of glass, yan, the Lamb will conquer them sa Revelation 17:14. Ito, military ang usage nito. Because we take it literally. No, they will conquer him when he comes from heaven. We believe this will happen literally. No, he will come from heaven and destroy them literally. And the one who conquers will have this heritage. I will be his God and he will be my son. So here, ang usage is about faith. Now, if they conquer, meaning they repent, they wake up, they will remain faithful, they hold fast. Ang reward nila is yung covenant promise, fulfillment ng covenant promise. I will be his God and he will be my son. So, we just establish yung relationship ng 1 John 5 sa ating series sa Book of Revelation. Dahil si John, ang author ng 1 John 5, si John din ang author ng Revelation. So, it must follow na yung idea ni John sa 1 John 5 nandun din sa Book of Revelation. Ang kaibahan lamang, itong 1 John 5 is a letter, an epistle, pero itong Revelation is more than a letter. At ngayon, dadako naman tayo sa introduction ng book or ng series natin, introduction proper ng ating series. So now, let's talk about the Book of Revelation. Now, what you see on your screen is the outline. Now, kung umatin kayo sa theology program, you should be familiar by this somehow. It's a little complicated right now. It just shows you how intricate or complex the Book of Revelation is. Dahil we try to fit into one page yung mga what we think are key phrases na makakatulong sa atin sa pag-unawa ng structure ng aklat. It's like a super Easter egg hunt. It's like an adventure. Studying the book is an adventure. May mga important keywords, key phrases that are like Easter eggs na makakatulong sa pag-unawa ng buong aklat. By understanding them, we get to see the treasure. Yun yung blessing. Blessing of hearing or reading the Word of God. Makukuha natin yung mga blessings by understanding those key phrases and keywords. And para siyang Easter egg na distributed throughout the book na dapat natin siyang, that dapat tayong mag-pay attention sa kanila. Merong tinatawag na narrative flow, ang isang kwento. Ito yung paano nila i-arrange yung pagkakasunod-sunod ng storya. Kung paano siya isulat or isalaysay nung writer o nung author. Now, normally, a narrative flow is linear. Nadire-diretso lang siya. Ideas and concepts and plot of events are arranged in a linear fashion. Sunod-sunod sila one after the other. Sa Book of Revelation, ganun siya. Visions are presented in sequential order. And I saw, and I hear, and so on and so forth. So, sunod-sunod po yun. In this case, ang mga sinasalaysay ng author ay prophetic events. Or, in this case, end-time events. When we say end-time, ang term po doon is eschatological. End-time is eschatological. So, end-time events. So, it's a prophecy about the end. Yan ang sinasalaysay, ninanarrate ng aklat ng Revelation. So, he's narrating it in sequential manner. And I saw, now on the superficial reading, on the surface, when you read it, a novice reader, a beginner, will see everything in linear fashion. No, syempre, may beginning yung kwento, may middle yung kwento, at may ending yung kwento. So, an ordinary reader will read it in one passing and see it as a linear narration. Yung may panimula, may prologue, and then may narration about the seven seals, the seven trumpets, the seven bowls, and then may conclusion, may epilogue, mayroong ending. Ang novice reader, ang beginner, ganyan ang makikita niya. Ganyan yung unang, sa unang pagbasa, ganyan yung ma-absorb mo. Okay? Example, sa kwentong ito, marami siyang theme. May iba't ibang tema ka na mapupulot. So, ang kinukuha natin, binibigyan natin na emphasis, yung theme about Christians becoming overcomers or being overcomers. Meron ding theme about, if you focus the story about Satan, no, kapag binasa mo yung pagkakasunod-sunod ng vision, you will see a steady progression kung paano mag-fall si Satan from heaven to earth, from earth to the abyss, from the abyss and back to earth, and then from earth to the lake of fire. It shows a linear progression ng fall ni Satan. From Revelation 12, he lost his place in heaven. Revelation 12:13, he was enraged because he lost his place in heaven, pursued the woman, and because the woman escaped or protected by God, ba? Sabi sa John, so 1 John 5, he is protected from the evil one. So they are protected by God, and so they managed to escape. And so, because of that, Satan was enraged, lalo siyang na-enraged against her seed. Yun ang persecute niya. And then we know sa Book of Revelation that the evil one or the beast is empowered to conquer the people of God. Yung seed of the woman, they are conquered for 3.5 years dito sa Book of Revelation. And then Jesus Christ comes sa Revelation 19, rescued them, defeated the conquered, the lamb conquered the beast and his armies. And so Satan, dahil doon, Satan is bound for 1,000 years, sa Revelation 20, 1-3. And after 1,000 years is finished, sa Revelation 20, he is released for a short time, deceived the nations, the whole world again, and the whole world launched an attack against the city where the saints are camped. And then they were defeated by a fire from heaven, from God, proving that he is protecting the city, is proving he's protecting his children. So 1 John 5, diba? Yun ang ating natutunan. We know that everyone fathered by God does not sin, but God protects the one he has fathered. New English translation. The evil one cannot touch him. Okay? And then finally, he is judged and sent to the lake of fire. So ito yung example ng isang linear theme about the fall of Satan in the Book of Revelation. Now, overall, if you keep reading the Book of Revelation, if you keep reading books about it and commentaries about it, like what I have done, because of this, it has become one of my favorite books, New Testament, is the Book of Revelation. The richness, yung yaman ng aklat na mapupulot natin dito sa aklat na ito, and I want to share that with you. At yung blessing na mapupulot natin dito every time we find the Easter eggs, every time we discover the meaning of the key words and phrases, you will benefit from it. I believe you will benefit from it. The more you study it, the more you learn new things, or actually, the more you discover things that you should have seen the first time around. And overall, we can say the apocalypse, the narration is not linear. Although linear ang pagkakakwento, yung mga events na kinakwento roon, they are non-linear. The book is employing many literary devices that we're not familiar with, that the more you read, you become familiar with it. Example, may mga flashback siya, may flash forward siya. Yung chronology of events are shifting from beginning to the middle to the end. And the key phrases are important because it helps us locate where those events are actually happening. Yun yung mga Easter egg na sinasabi natin. Now, makakatulong doon yung mga tinatawag na interludes. Interludes are breaks in the narrative flow. Binibreak niya yung flow ng narration. Dahil dun sa mga interludes na yon, between the 6th and 7th seals, mayroong interlude. Between the 6th and 7th trumpet, may interlude. Between the 7th trumpet and the first bowl or vial of the wrath of God, may interlude. After the 7th vial is poured out, mayroong interlude. Those interludes are breaks in the narration, and dito pumapasok yung flashbacks at flash forwards that will help us understand yung meaning ng mga vision na kinukwento sa atin ni John dito sa Book of Revelation. Now, another important tip, and napaka-importanting malaman ito ng bawat isa, the opening chapters are important keys to understanding the rest of the book. First set of chapters, especially chapter 1 hanggang chapter 5, these are very important. Kaya I don't want you to miss them. It's important that you attend this first the discussion of these first five chapters. No, the prologue, the message to the seven churches, and the heavenly court. Ang pinaka-importante dito yung message to the seven churches. They have the keys to understanding the rest of the book. Now let's talk about the narrative flow and the events that it's talking about. Yung order of visions na kinukwento ni John, yung narration niya, linear yon. Pero yung mga nilalaman ng kwento niya, yung mga events na nandun sa kwento niya, they are not in parallel with his narration. Okay? So, ibig sabihin, yung kinakwento niya, dire-diretso, yung mga nilalaman ng kwento niya ay hango sa iba't ibang bahagi ng future events. Okay, let me just give you an example. Yung city. Let's talk about the city. Sa Hebrews 11, naalala niya, di ba? Di nila na pasok yung city. They did not receive what was promised. But even though they did not receive that was promised, they remained faithful to him. Yung faith nila, they were sure by faith that their hope is they're not going to fail sa kanilang hope. Faith is the assurance of the things hoped for. They were sure, although they died not receiving the promises, like the patriarchs, for instance, Abraham. He was looking forward to the city that has the foundations and whose designer and builder is God. So, itong city na to is the same city that is discussed dito sa Book of Revelation. Now, kadalasan, ang Book of Revelation, yung gitna, yung seven seals, yung seven trumpets, yung seven bowls, hindi yun pinipreach kadalasan. No, kadalasan ang pinipreach lang yung first five chapters, especially yung chapter 2 and 3 tungkol sa seven churches, and then the rest are abandoned, yung seven seals, seven trumpets, seven bowls. And then another favorite sources ng preaching itong Revelation 21 and 22. Not as favorite dun sa chapter 2 and chapter 3. Pero kasi dito, kinukwento yung dinidescribe dito yung end times. Ito yung mangyayari when Christ comes. No, ang kadalasan tinuturo ay when you die, you go to heaven. Pero when you read this, chapter 21 to 22 is not talking about going to heaven. It's talking about heaven, the city from heaven coming down on earth, on the new heaven and the new earth. This earth will be replaced by the new heaven and the new earth. And in this new heaven and the new earth, the city, the new city, the new Jerusalem, the holy city will come from heaven, out of heaven, from God, to as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. Ang tinutukoy dito yung people of God. Now, ito yung kinoconnect natin dito, yung Hebrews, yung city na yon na nilulook forward ng patriarchs. They're looking forward to that city. That city sa Revelation, sa Book of Revelation, that city will come down from out of heaven from God. Now, itong city na ito, dinidescribe dito, the way it is described in Revelation 21 and Revelation 22, yung city na ito ay tinitirhan ng mga tinatawag na those who wash their robes. Sila yung may right to eat from the tree and go through the gates of the city. May mga tao nakatira doon. Yung kanilang robes malinis, meron silang karapatang to eat the tree from the tree of life, and they have the rights to go through the gates into the city. Now, kapag binasa mo yung chapter 21 and chapter 22, apart from the book, you will think that this is talking about the eternity na. No? New heaven and new earth na eh. Wala nang kasunod doon. This is forever and ever. Now, remember those keywords, the city. Now, pagdating sa, if you read the Revelation 20, yung controversial chapter about the millennium, pinagtatalunan ito ng mga Christian, kung si Christ ba ay darating before the millennium, after the millennium, or after the millennium. Now, if you read Revelation 20, after the 1,000 years, sa Revelation 27 to 9, ang sabi doon, Satan deceived the nations, the world, they gathered around the city, surrounded the camp of the saints and the beloved city. Yan yung tinatawag nating example ng Easter egg. Now, ano yung city na yun? Bakit nandun yung city sa millennium? Eh, ang city na yun, sabi sa Revelation 21, will come down out of heaven from God. Now, is he talking about the old city, itong city ng dyan sa Israel ngayon? Or is this the same city that came down from heaven? What I propose to you is that this city where the saints are camped, nakakampo sila, is the same beloved city that comes down from heaven, out of heaven from God. Now, bakit nandun na siya sa 20 samantalang nasa Revelation 21 pa lang siya bumababa? Yan po yung sinasabi natin na hindi siya linear yung events. Although linear ang pagkakakwento, syempre kinuwento muna yung chapter 20 bago kinuwento yung 21, yung events na kinilalaman ng kwento ay hindi linear. Okay? Nag-flash. Dito, tinuloy niya yung kwento sa Revelation 20, tinapos niya, and then sa kanya kinuwento yung city na nandon sa Revelation 20. So, if you put 2 and 2 together, ibig sabihin, bumaba na yung new heaven and new earth na itong 1,000 years na ito. Okay? At, yung city na yan, how do we confirm that? Kasi ang susi, like I said, nasa chapter 2 and chapter 3, or sa first 5 chapters, especially chapter 2 and chapter 3, ang pangako doon sa kanila ay, the one who conquers, listen to what the Spirit says to the churches. Although sinabi to sa isang church, listen to what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who conquers, I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem, which comes down from heaven, from my God out of heaven, and my own new name. Ibig sabihin, pinapangako ito ng Panginoon sa kanyang mga kapatid, sa kanyang pagbabalik, sila ay titira doon sa city na yon. At natupad yon sa Revelation 19 and 20, kung saan doon na sila tumira. And then after 1,000 years, sinalakay ito, and to prove that God is protecting them, that they remain secure, yung attack na yon came to nothing in an instant when fire came down from heaven. Again, this is an example. Yung nilalaman ng narration nila ay hindi siya linear. Sa Revelation 24, they came to life and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. Where did they reign? They reigned in the city where they camped. The beloved city. Now, saan ang galing yung city na yun? Bakit nandun na kagad yung city? Now, Revelation 20 explains that city came down out of heaven from God. Crucial yung understanding na yun. Because it determines what kind of premillennialism you are going to be. Yung classical, historic premillennialism. No, pareho na silang historic kasi history na sila. Eh, no? Pero yung classical, when you talk about classical, I'm talking about the first 3 century of Christianity, yung paniniwala ng first 3 centuries of Christianity, naniniwala sila na since they understand that the book of Revelation is telling a non-linear event, sa kanila, yung 1,000 years in Jerusalem is part of the new heaven and the new earth. And that the promise or the covenanted kingdom never ends na from that time on. Now, they're not confusing the sovereignty of God. It never ends. Hindi yun nawala ever. Yung kingdom on earth, yun ang nawala dahil they were exiled. Yung kingdom na binigay ni God sa Israel through David and his children and his sons, nawala yun. So, yung kingdom na yun, ang pinapanalangin na ma-restore. Kaya, ang prayer is that your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Yun ang prayer ni Lord. So, hindi nawawala yung kingdom, yung sovereignty ni God sa hubung universe. Ang earth lang, ang naging rebelde. Dahil yung children niya, yung Israel na magiging blessing dapat sa mga nations ay hindi sumusunod sa covenant nila kay God. So finally, when Christ comes, that promise, that kingdom will be restored, and ang son ni David ang magre-reign, and he will reign forever and ever. That kingdom will never end. Katulad ng mga sinasabi sa mga creeds ng Christendom. Kaya crucial yung understanding na yung linear na kwento is telling non-linear events in the story. Kaya kahit na ang city binanggit sa Revelation 20 at yung 1,000 years binanggit sa Revelation 20, the early Christians understood that is already part of the new heaven and the new earth. Pero yung mga modern premillennialists, mga dispensationalists, they see it simply as linear. Oh, sinabi yan sa Revelation 20, yung 1,000 years, and then therefore, yung Revelation 21 to 22, yun na yung new heaven and new earth. Alright? Okay. Now, what are the different ways of reading the end time prophecies? There are different ways of reading it, especially the book of Revelation. So those who are reading it today, looking back to AD 70, when Jerusalem was destroyed, after Jesus Christ was crucified, resurrected, and ascended to heaven, within the generation, the temple was destroyed according to the prophecy of Jesus on the Mount of Olives. Now, in the present day, when you read the book of Revelation, there are different ways. People, Christians, read the end time prophecies in the book of Revelation. Number one, futurism. Majority of Christians see a large portion of the end time events in the book of Revelation being fulfilled in the future and in the literal sense. No, literally will be fulfilled in the future. Majority ng Christianity, yan ang paniniwala. Even the first century Christians, second century Christians, third century Christians, and then in between, nagkaroon na ng unti-unting yung iba nagsasabi na okay, na-fulfill na itong millennium dito sa present time natin. And then pagdating sa 16th century, na-fulfill na itong Great Tribulation sa AD 70. Doon pa lang. Pero majority ng Christian throughout history and even to the present interprets the book of Revelation as to be fulfilled in the future and interpret them literally. There are, like I said, Christians from the 16th century, from the Reformation, 15th century, 16th century, 18th century, and even now, many of them, they believe that some or partial of the end time events prophesied in the book of Revelation are fulfilled in the past, especially in AD 70 when the temple was destroyed. Ang tawag po doon preterism. They see the meaning or the interpretation of the end time prophecies fulfilled in the past. Preterit, past. Now, another way of looking at the book of Revelation is interpreting the end time prophecies being fulfilled through real persons, places, and events throughout history, not just in AD 70. No? Nakikita nila yung mga events na kinukwento sa Book of Revelation, ina-associate nila ito sa real persons, places, and events in history. Maraming ganyan nung time ng mga reformers. Sila Martin Luther. Ganyan yung kanilang ginawa. Sila Bengal. At nauso pa rin nga yung time na ito ang date fixing. Nilalagyan nila ng date kung kailan na fulfill. Kasi they are associating the prophecies of the end times sa real persons, places, events in history, they must have dates when they were fulfilled. Kaya malaki yung burden of proof na nakapatong sa balikat ng mga historicist. When they are interpreting and they are following this school of thought, the burden of proof is for them to prove kung sino yung fulfillment at kailan siya na-fulfill. Oh, so, kakaiba siya dito sa preterism na para sa kanila, pinagkasya, ginampak nila ang mga events parang sardina sa AD 70. Ito naman, dinistribute nila throughout history. So kaya ang burden of proof sa kanila to provide the dates kung kailan yun na-fulfill. Nang sumunod ay idealism. No? They interpret prophecies in the book of Revelation about the end times analogically. So it can apply to the past, it can apply to the present, and it can apply to the future. Analogical kasi siya. So may mga events na nangyari sa past na can relate to them, applicable to them. May nangyari sa present natin na similar sa past na dinidescribe, similar sa dinidescribe ng Revelation, applicable din ito sa atin. And it's also applicable to the future. Advantage nito, the meaning is arbitrary. No, you don't have to fix dates. You don't have to have exact literal fulfillment. Analogical kasi eh. Now, lahat sila may mga strengths and weaknesses. For the purpose of our study, we're going to look into their interpretation. When it comes to exegesis, syempre, preterist tayo. When it comes to interpretation, syempre, futurist tayo. When it comes to application, syempre, idealist tayo. In other words, our study of the end times will be eclectic. It will be a combination of these different schools of interpretation. Dahil nga sa different ways of reading the end time prophecies in the book of Revelation, different schools of thought has emerged. Different models of the end times has emerged. So, ayan, makikita niyo yung family tree ng different models of eschatology. So dito, ang dividing line is yung Revelation 20. Like I said, it's controversial. If you believe it's a present reality, ang tawag po doon ay amillennialism. Or, more appropriately, we should call them now millennialism. Kasi, ang tunay na amillennialist, if you study the history of ang tunay na amillennialist, ay mga agnostics. They don't believe in the millennium. Etong mga modern-day amillennialist brothers natin, they believe in the millennium, but they believe it's happening now. They think they're enjoying it now. At dalawang klase po yun, may Augustinian at may Warfieldian. At dito kay Warfield, kiniklaim ng mga post-millennialist na magkakaroon ng literal future golden age through the success of preaching the gospel. Si Warfield ang kanilang sinasabi nilang pinagbabasihan nilang theologians. Kiniklaim nila, actually kiniklaim din nila si Augustine actually, no? Pero kiniklaim nila more si Warfield na nagpopularize ng post-millennialism. Post-millennialism means Christ comes after the millennium. Because they are also a branch of amillennialism. They think they are enjoying the millennium now. They are enjoying Revelation 20 now. They have a spiritual or allegorical ways of interpreting Revelation 20. Now, dito sa futurist, those who believe that Revelation 20 is still future, those who believe that the millennium, the thousand years in Jerusalem will happen only after Christ comes in the future, ang tawag po doon ay premillennialist. Ang unang premillennialist ay ang tinatawag na historic premillennialist. And they were post-tribulational. Ibig sabihin, naniniwala sila noon na Christ will come after the great tribulation. When he comes, church, the elect will be gathered to him through angels. They will be raptured to Christ. And they will appear with him in glory coming down from heaven. Now, itong dispensational, ito ay 19th century revival ng premillennialism. Kaya lang ang kaibahan dito, ang rapture sa kanila ay pre-tribulational. Yan po ang iba't ibang models of eschatology na nabuo because of the different ways of reading the book of Revelation. Now, another way of presenting the different models of eschatology, yan, makikita nyo dyan ang pagkakaiba-iba nila. Itong now-millennialist at post-millennialist, sila ay naniniwala na they are enjoying the millennial kingdom now and Christ will come after the millennial kingdom. Kaya ang tawag nila doon, already, not yet. They are already enjoying the kingdom, but not yet in the sense that it's not yet consumed. No, it's not yet consumed. Kasi pagdating ni Christ, para sa kanila, the kingdom will be consumed. Consummation na ng kingdom. Tapos na yung reign pagdating ni Christ. Sa atin, sa mga premillennialist tulad natin, pagdating ni Christ, doon pa lang magre-reign si Christ on earth. Doon pa lang ma-answer yung prayer na, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Doon pa lang mangyayari. And kaibahan ng post-millennialist sa now-millennialist, they have a golden age period, okay, before Christ's coming, the coming of Christ. Yan po yung different ways of presenting the different models of eschatology. Now, although may pagkakaiba tayo, I just wanna point out that may pagkakatulad din po tayo. So these are the five major points of agreement between the different schools of interpretation, the different views about the end times. We all agree that there will be a second coming. No, agree tayo po lahat doon. We all agree that it is future. Except, yung mga preterists, extreme preterists, na nagki-claim na dumating na yung second coming by form of judgment. May mga ganun po. With those few exceptions, we all agree that the second coming is still future. And we all agree the general resurrection is still future. And we all agree that the final judgment is still future. And we all agree that the new creation is still future. Except with a few exceptions. Those preterists who believe that the new creation, the new heaven and the new earth, is started in parallel when the new covenant was established by Christ. Yun po yung few exceptions. And we all believe that there is a future eternal state. So, kahit may pagkakaiba tayo, meron din naman tayong pagkakatulad na dapat nating i-celebrate. I hope by this, we get a little bit prepared what to expect sa bago nating series on the Book of Revelation, following up on our 21st anniversary theme, We Shall Overcome.